1750, and I went into the registry in Sweden, where in the entire Scandinavian region, there is very organized record of when people were born, when did they die, whether or not they suffered major diseases. Each community kept a very, very well organized record. So they looked into the question of longevity for 100 years, from 1750 to 1850, in Sweden, and what they found was that actually people who were sick early in their development were at a risk not to live long. When inflammatory disease in early childhood, which was very difficult those days, there were no antibiotics, any child who was sick for weeks. Other researchers looked at the growth curves, and children who were severely sick stopped growing, which is today used to explain at least part of the difference in height between generations. So these were the years where every disease caused severe difficulties, and apparently diseases even shortened lifespan. When people were aged, then the issue of neurodegenerative disease appeared. And now I'd like to ask you, what do you think is the reason for neurodegenerative disease? Why do people get sick? Why is the brain more sensitive than other organs? Anyone with a tentative explanation? Genetics is always correct for any disease, but that's a superficial explanation, right? It's easy to say, genetics. Why is the nervous system more sensitive? Ken? Okay, you're talking about personal experience. Okay, that's one reason. And of course, inheritance is another reason, but we still didn't. I'm sorry.
I say that it grows old, like the whole body, because in the childhood, you say children, they're more active, and in the age person, they cannot do what child is.
Well, you're getting closer. It grows older much more than other tissues in the body, because most of the nerve cells cannot be replaced. Okay, there's very little cell division in the brain. We can renovate muscle cells and spleen cells and liver cells, but we have to do with that set of nerve cells that we acquired in very early development. So a nerve cell needs to live 80 years. That's a long time. Yeah. Well, also in the brain. We say there is cell division also in the brain, but it's minute. People took pieces of brain from aged individuals and showed that they still contain stem cells and the stem cells divide. So there is cell division, but it's a very, very modest cell division compared to muscle, for example. Okay, so now let's say there are two basic explanations for neurodegenerative disease. One says, this is a system where we have to do with those cells we were born with, and over the years we accumulate damages just because time goes by. And when we accumulate too many damages, then the entire system will collapse. This is what we call neurodegenerative disease. But there is a more sophisticated explanation that says, true, the system is very complicated. We have to do with those cells that we were born with. But when something goes wrong, the system activates correction processes. And neurodegeneration will start when the correction fails. So you have many parts, something goes bad, we activate a sort of a feedback response. The system solves that problem, and another, until finally it has no solutions. And this is neurodegeneration. By the way, I told you last week about Alzheimer's disease clock test. This is an attempt on the screen of an Alzheimer's disease patient to draw a clock. And you see that they lose the concept of a closed circle for the clock. So this is a very famous demonstration of the Alzheimer's characteristic deterioration. But today we want to talk about Parkinson's disease. Okay. So first of all, how many people get sick? Much less than Alzheimer's, 1 to 2% of the population above the age of 65 years. Still, it is the second most common neurodegenerative disease, which means that the others are really rare. This is, after Alzheimer's, the most abundant one. And almost each one of us saw, at some point, a Parkinson's disease patient. So, I brought you last week quotation from Shakespeare, so let's continue this theme. And actually, if we look at what Shakespeare wrote, we find out that he was really understanding contemporary medicine. He knew the symptoms, and he referred many times to the tremor, which again comes to tell you that when we talk about extended life expectancy, the rich people who had enough food and lived under convenient conditions in Shakespeare's days lived to develop Parkinson's disease. So they reached the age of 70 and more, although life expectancy was about 40. So there was a very big discrepancy between life expectancy in different communities. And what does Shakespeare say? In Richard II, the aging Duke of York, he complains that he cannot move his arm, and he says, how quickly should this arm of mine now prisoner to the palsy? The palsy is the typical tremor of Parkinson's disease. And then in another play, Ulysses connects palsy with the shaking of tremor, and he says, and with a palsy fumbling on his gorget, shake in and out of the rivet. And the a little bit amusing part is in Henry IV, when Dick asks, why does you quiver, man? And the response from Lord Say is, it is the palsy, it's not fear provokes me. So I'm not trembling because I'm afraid. And the Lord himself also shakes his head repeatedly, and Jake says, I'll see if his head will stand steadier on a pole. So they were really very gentle people in those days. Anyway, the term palsy is most likely the description of the Parkinsonian tremor. So the disease exists for many years. It was first described only in 1817 by an English physician. So anyone who tells you the Parkinson's disease, this is wrong. Parkinson's disease is called that name after James Parkinson, who wrote an essay on the shaking palsy. And this is the gentleman. And then of course, they were rivals with the French scientists. And a famous neurologist, Monsieur Charcot, from the Salpêtrière Hospital in Paris, this is Monsieur Charcot, described the syndrome in the late 1800s. But if you ask a French medical student who discovered Parkinson's disease, they will only remember Monsieur Charcot. Okay. So James Parkinson. He described the disease as involuntary tremulous motion. He described the difficulty to pass from a walking to a running pace. He described the shaking palsy. And again, this is where he lived, in London. And the interesting point I'd like you to pay attention to is this guy I showed you last week. This is Alois Alzheimer. And this guy, his name was Friedrich Levy, or Louis. I have a friend from Tel Aviv University. Whenever we come to an international conference and someone says, Louis, he gets up and he says, this is Levi, so that everyone will know where it comes from. And it is interesting that they both worked in the same place at the years when the big discoveries were each decade or so a new disease had been discovered. And now I'll tell you a little bit later what did Louis describe. Now, I told you last week that Alzheimer's disease damages the entire cortex, that there is massive loss of mass. It's very different for Parkinson's disease. If we talk about the human brain, over here there is a very small region called the substantia nigra, and it's called that way because the cells are black, nigra in Latin, and are black because they produce a pigment called melatonin, the same type of pigment that makes our skin dark. And those nerve cells are the ones that die in Parkinson's disease, so very small region in the brain. That was the reason for studies that we'll discuss a little bit later, where people decided to try to implant the missing cells into the brain of sick patients. So stem cell therapy was started for Parkinson's disease, and there are some conclusions already. So again, this is the cortex, and here are the nuclei, and this nucleus, the substantia nigra, is the main source of one neurotransmitter, not acetylcholine that we discussed last week, but another chemical, dopamine. Dopamine is very important for many different behavior types, and indeed Parkinson's patients are affected not only in their motor symptoms, but also in their behavior patterns. So how is the disease defined? What you see is within those nerve cells that produce dopamine, you see protein precipitates. Now, you'll immediately note the similarity. So last week we talked about protein precipitates outside of nerve cells. Now we're talking about precipitates inside the cell. In each case, something goes wrong in the metabolism of proteins, in the way they get born, in the way they find their place in the cell, in the way they die. They sort of form clamps that are dangerous for the survival of these nerve cells, but now they form only in cells that act through dopamine. Okay. The precipitates are called Lewy bodies because they were discovered by Friedrich Levy, the one we saw in the picture. And this description was in 1912, so about 100 years after the disease was described, the pathology came through, which is very different from Alzheimer's because Alzheimer's described the disease with the pathology, but this was in the 1900s when the technology was available. And medicine is technology oriented. The advance in medicine is very much determined by changes in technology. So the inclusions are particularly numerous in the substantia nigra, in a very small part of it, substantia nigra pars compacta, if anyone is really interested. And this is the region in the brain. And here is how it looks. If we'll prepare a section through the brain, over here, horizontal section, this is how the brain will look. And here we'll see, without staining, cells that are black. This is the substantia nigra. If we make a parallel section from the brain of a Parkinson's patient, you see that? We lost most of the cells. And actually, Parkinsonian symptoms only start when over 70% of the dopaminergic neurons have died already. So that has several implications. First, it says, as we discussed earlier, that the brain activates control mechanism. It already lost half of the nerve cells But we don't know that yet. The patient doesn't know that yet. So there is a lot of correction processes, which not all of which we recognize yet. Another thing it implies is that when the patient is diagnosed, it's too late to treat, because most of the nerve cells responsible for dopaminergic functions have died already. So again, a very important unmet need is to develop early diagnosis for Parkinson's disease, hoping that that would lead to a real treatment. Okay, yeah. Okay, these are cells that produce a chemical, dopamine, that interacts in other nerve cells with receptors, with channels, with proteins on the membrane that recognize this chemical selectively. And when there is interaction between dopamine and the dopamine receptors, then those cells create electrical activity. They are activated only in the presence of dopamine. So if we lose the cells that produce dopamine, they cannot get activated. And these are the cells that send messages to the body. This is how you should control muscle tone, muscle movement. If the cells are gone, then the muscles are activated wildly without control. Okay? Yeah. What could you read that again? Precipitate. Okay, I said that in Alzheimer's disease there is a protein, we discussed that last week, that creates clumps, precipitates outside the nerve cell. It's secreted, and then something goes wrong, and it creates these clumps. In Parkinson's disease, we see parallel clumps, but they appear within the cell, because the protein that forms them is not destined to be secreted. Okay? But the concept is the same. Something goes wrong in the life cycle of that protein. Yes?
Is there a loss of or degeneration of dopaminergic cells in other brain zones, like BPA,
yes,
for instance?
Yes, definitely. This is the center, and that's the major damage. But there are precipitates of synuclein. This is the protein that forms these precipitates, even in peripheral tissues, except that the dopaminergic neurons are most sensitive. Okay? So what are Lewy bodies? And that's the answer to your question, but it was not an invited question. That the precipitates are not limited to the substantia nigra and can be found in different parts of the brain. And in the olfactory bulb, in that region of the brain, in the front of the brain, that is responsible for controlling smell sensations. This is why patients first lose their smell, okay? Because these neurons also develop precipitates. And in the autonomic nervous system, outside the brain, okay? But it's mainly nerve cells. Other cells do not develop these precipitates. Okay, so something bad happens to nerve cells, which is why the disease starts. And I want to show you how these Lewy bodies look. This is a Lewy body over here, over here. I can share with you a personal story. I have a second generation cousin who suddenly developed the urge to gamble, to take risks, to take her husband's car and disappear for days, and everyone was really concerned. And they went to a neurologist, and the neurologist identified Lewy body dementia, so Parkinsonism with this kind of precipitates. And he said, "I'm sorry, I apologize, I have to report to the authorities that you're not allowed to drive from now on." I mean, getting out of his office, she couldn't drive home, which was a major crisis, but the loss of behavior and control is apparently a typical characteristic. of Parkinson's disease, especially in that when we have lowy bodies. But the symptoms are more than that. So the head is rigidly positioned and trembled. There is a tilt of the trunk. People do not stand straight. They cannot swing their arm freely, but they do show a tremor, and they have a shuffling gait. They have difficulties to walk. They take very short steps. Okay, so again, this is the substantia nigra, and here is what goes wrong. In the normal brain, a cell from the substantia nigra sends dopamine, which activates the other nerve cells that control muscle movement. In the Parkinsonian brain, we lose most of the dopamine, and therefore, there is a movement disorder. So anyone can suggest, what would you do if you wanted to develop therapy? Of course.
But it is impossible to use dopamine because dopamine does not cross the blood-brain barrier and cannot go into the
correct. And it would degrade very rapidly. So pharmacologists set to their drawing board and developed an analog of dopamine, which is stable and can cross the blood-brain barrier. Okay, L-DOPA, right. But we'll get to that. There is a difference in the incidence of Parkinsonism. So you see here that after the age of 80, if you did not develop Parkinson's disease, you probably won't any longer, which is good news. The prevalence will therefore be quite stable after the age of 70 or so, unlike Alzheimer, which keeps increasing. And what is the epidemiology? How spread is it worldwide? Much less in China and other Asian countries, in African American countries. The prevalence rate are slightly higher in men than women, inverse from Alzheimer, and it's not known why. And this is the information as it was deposited on the website in 2006 when we prepared this review. And this is Liat, that's her PhD thesis. And you see here the difference in the prevalence. So not incidence, not new cases, but how many cases are there per 100,000 citizens in different countries. Tremendous difference between China, where it's really low, and this is corrected for life expectancy, which is somewhat shorter in China. So not only don't they develop it, but some of them die too early for us to know. But still, those countries that use a lot of agricultural chemicals suffer the highest prevalence of Parkinsonism. So again, we are talking about inheritance as a first cause. Sometimes people ask me, how do I avoid develop Parkinson's disease? And again, I need to say, you have to pick your parents very carefully, because there is a major inheritance factor, although there's only 17% of the patients developed it because of an inherited mutation in a known gene. There are 9 different genes where mutations would facilitate the development of Parkinsonism. And 83% of the patients do not have any of these mutations, and yet they become Parkinsonian. No, we corrected for that. No. We corrected for that factor. They do have, apparently, a much better genetics in terms of the risk to develop Parkinson's disease. Or the Chinese government does not report all the cases, which is something we have to consider because they had other diseases that they were proven not to report correctly to the World Health Organization. Yeah.
Could it be environmental?
It could definitely be environmental, because if the countries where there is intensive agriculture, there's also the highest level. Then researchers went in and found out that people who live in rural areas, so they are more exposed to chemicals because of agriculture as compared to those in town, for example, they have a higher risk. People who use insecticides have a higher risk. So again, avoid insecticides if you only can. Organic diet. Okay. So what are the risk factors? So the very first one is, of course, age. Positive family history, anyone who had in previous generations. Sorry?
Predisposition.
Yeah. Yeah. Male gender, a little bit higher risk. Environmental exposure. Herbicide, pesticide exposure, metals. Well water, which is less pure than the circulated one. Farming, rural residence. Wood pulp mills, again, because of exposure to chemicals. Steel industry, for sure chemicals. So metals are bad news for brain neurons. We learned that last week for Alzheimer's. It's the same for Parkinson. Race, so ethnic origin. And then life experiences. The highest risk above from all these is head injury. People who suffer massive head injury, people who choose boxing for a living, are at much elevated risk for Parkinson's disease. And some people say personality traits. People who tend to be depressive and shy, they claim are at higher risk to develop Parkinson's disease compared to those who are extroverts in their character. I'm not sure to what extent this has been established, though. Okay, inverse correlation, which is really interesting, is between cigarette smoking and caffeine. So if you smoke and or if you are, as I am, coffee addicts, then the risk is limited. I'm not saying that coffee is very good for you, but for this disease, it is good. Or you might say otherwise, that people who are on the verge of developing Parkinson cannot smell coffee, so they don't enjoy it anymore. Maybe that would be a cause. So nobody knows to differentiate. But here are two very famous Parkinson's patients. So this is Muhammad Ali, who entertained one major risk. He used boxing as a profession. And this is Michael J. Fox. Now, for him, there's another story. Apparently, he was on a set of filming a movie in the Bahama Islands. And he and three of the other actors had a party. Whatever they smoked or injected there, nobody knows, but all four developed early onset Parkinsonism, which, I don't know, I'm very careful not to say, this is what I read, that's as far as I know. And Michael J. Fox actually created a huge fund that supports Parkinson's research. For very significant sums, because he's really eager to find a solution. Now, there is a history which is very well recorded of the risk of drug abuse as a source for developing Parkinsonism. So in the 1920s, in Los Angeles, there were young people who were showing suddenly in intensive care units with terrible Parkinsonian symptoms that they said they didn't had anything 1 week before, which is very untypical because this disease starts slowly and accumulates. And in this case, what happened was there was a chemist that was synthesizing LSD, and in those years it was not illegal. So he was identified and nobody could do anything. And he was not a very good chemist. And the LSD synthesized was impure with a compound which we call MPTP for a long name, and exposing a monkey to that compound, within 2 days the monkey will become badly Parkinsonian. So That showed us what are the nerve cells that are sensitive, because MPTP mimics the structure of dopamine. Yes?
So generally, the use of dopaminergic stimulants, like even Ritalin, for instance, is putting a higher risk.
Like even what?
Ritalin, for instance.
Nobody found evidence for risk of Ritalin. People were looking at that. I don't know to answer, though, because the use of Ritalin is not long enough for people to accumulate, to reach the age. When we run a study, we say these are Parkinson's patients and these are apparently healthy volunteers, because they're only apparently healthy because nobody knows what will happen to them 5 years from now. Okay? So this is another study from Hong Kong. You see the gait, you see the difficulties to stand straight, to move arms, to move legs. What are the clinical features? So we mentioned resting tremor without trying to do any movement, the hands particularly. Mostly one hand will tremor very badly. Bradykinesia is difficulty with daily activities like writing or shaving or using knife and fork, opening buttons, decreased blinking. The face loses expression. There was, about 10 years ago, I went to a conference, a huge conference in Argentina, and I was sitting listening to the lecturer and looking at a row in the other side of the hall, and I thought, this should be this and that professor that I know from Tel Aviv University, but it doesn't look like him. And then I met him, and he looked different, and 2 months later, I found that he was badly Parkinsonian. So they really lose facial expression and difficulties to chew and swallow. And rigidity. So the muscles, even if they're not tremored, they're abnormal in their posture. And if you, and of course, as I said, they would have difficulty to keep their knees and elbows straight and stand straight. And this is just the impairment in writing. So you see how a patient writes when he's well, and you see how he writes when the drug is not affecting him. Yes?
So how difficult is it to tell during the early phases of Parkinson's whether the clinical symptoms are Parkinsonian or not? Because I feel like many seniors exhibit in mild forms, at least some,
yeah.
Not always.
Yeah. And the same would be true for Alzheimer's. So. Aging is accompanied by death of nerve cells, and some of the dopaminergic nerve cells would die also in healthy individuals. So what is done is to run brain mapping activities, and I'll get to this in a minute. So postural instability, the reflex for standing straight is gone. Dysfunction of the autonomic nervous system. So they would have a problem with digestion, with bladder function, with sweating, okay? So, and depression. Depression is really bad, although, again, depression is a characteristic of aging. So some people would get depressed without being Parkinsonian. About one third of Parkinsonian patients would also show cognitive impairment, and it is not clear yet whether they also have Alzheimer's, which is a possibility, or if this is due to the Parkinsonian symptoms. And there are, as I said, 9 genes. The very first one was discovered in Japan, where there was a family pedigree with early Parkinsonism, like the age of 25 or so. Very early, and they called the gene Parkin, and then all the other genes were gradually called Park1, Park2, and so on. And the number one gene, this Parkin, is the source of the protein that causes those Lewy precipitates. The protein is called synuclein because it's a nuclear protein, And this is the major constituent. Now, I just want to show you this very complex scheme so that you'll see those processes that we discussed last week. So, we're talking about mitochondrial dysfunction. Part of the genes causing Parkinsonism disrupt the functioning of mitochondria. We're talking about protein death being impaired. That's why the proteins cause precipitates. And we are talking about cell death, in this case, of a particular type of cells and the formation of Lewy bodies. Okay. So what can we say about the functional neuroanatomy? What does the substantia nigra do in a healthy brain? So it provides dopamine. Dopamine controls behavior, general feeling, positive feeling, risk-taking behavior is controlled by dopamine.
Pleasure.
I'm sorry?
Pleasure.
Hedonian feelings are controlled by dopamine. And it controls transfer of information from the cortex to brain nuclei. And posture and muscle tone, okay? That we are going to cut off. And here is a little bit about what happens to dopamine. So here is a normal person. The substantia nigra is here. This is the cortex. The substantia nigra communicates with what we call the basal nuclei or basal ganglia, which are not part of the cortex, so they're inside the brain. And dopamine stimulates the function, and then this sends messages to the spinal cords and controls muscle activity. Now, last week we learned about acetylcholine. And the interesting point is that acetylcholine works against dopamine. These two neurotransmitters create a balance. Under normal condition, one does its job and the other does its job. If we change the level of dopamine, there is too much acetylcholine, too much inhibition. So we need to set the balance straight. So here is what happens in a patient. There is the brain, the motor cortex, but it doesn't send enough dopamine to the brain nuclei. And therefore, the inhibition is much more dramatic. And there is increased muscle tension and tremor. So this is what Parkinson's disease is in terms of the nervous system. What about treatment? Because people realize that there is too much acetylcholine relatively in the Parkinsonian brain, they started by modifying cholinergic functions. This is taken from a paper by Duvoisier, and this is a French neurologist who published this study in 1967. And what you see here is the capacity of a Parkinsonian patient to draw a spiral, okay? You see that he started off very bad, but then they gave him belladonna drops. The belladonna is a plant that produces a compound called atropine. We know about atropine. Atropine is in the syringes, in the chemical warfare kits that each of us is supposed to keep at home. It's an anticholinergic. So the assumption was there is too much acetylcholine, let's block it. We'll give belladonna drops, which are given actually in Imodium, in the anti-diarrhea drug. This is belladonna drops. This is the major component. So what happened is the capacity to draw spirals improved significantly. And then they tried the opposite. Physostigma venenosum is a plant that was found in Africa, and it has the opposite effect. It blocks the protein that degrades acetylcholine. Now, let me tell you how physostigma was discovered. There was a British pharmacologist called Bentley who went to Africa in search for therapeutic plants in 18-something, So, of course, by a boat. And he got there and he learned about this plant, which he calls a calabar bean. And I read about that in a textbook about the cholinergic system that was published by another French, British pharmacologist in 1972. So she says that Bentley learned about this bean, and it is used for witchcraft medicine. So if, for example, a woman is suspected of betraying her husband, the tribes would take her into the community and force her to swallow ground calabar beans. And the concept was, if she tells the truth, she will throw up, which is a reaction to cholinergic hyperexcitation, and survive. But if she's lying, so she would be really tense. And in that case, she would have a lot of feedback response to the excess acetylcholine. By having a lot of acetylcholinesterase in the epithelial tissues, she would swallow the poison and die because too much of it in the stomach is intolerable. So this, of course, solved the problems. No need of jail. Anyone who is guilty dies immediately. And Bentley took this calabar bean with him. And the textbook says that in the cabin, in the boat, he cut one bean to 8 pieces and ground 1/8 and chewed on it. There were no symptoms, so he ground another 1/8 of a bean. And then he developed double vision and started sweating and developed all of those cholinergic symptoms that we know from our studies. And he wrote that in his book, and the textbook says, and survived to perform yet more hair-raising experiments. So I like that textbook. Yeah.
Can you explain again how does the atropine help?
Okay. What atropine does is to block the acetylcholine receptor. So there is too much acetylcholine compared to dopamine, but now you block its capacity to interact with the receptor because the receptor is blocked. So you retrieve a little bit of the balance. Okay, this is why it helps. On the other hand, you cannot take atropine routinely, and you did not solve the dopaminergic problem. So this was the beginning of therapeutics, but certainly not satisfactory. Okay, so the issue is the balance between acetylcholine and dopamine. Now, who knows who is that? I expect humanity students to read books. So this is Oliver Sacks. Highly recommended books, and this is taken from the cover of his recent book about understanding music. He's a neurologist, grew up in London, but lives in New York. He's actually, I read his new book, which is an autobiography, and learned that he's a cousin of Abba Ibn, so he has family in Israel, but he's not Zionistic. And he writes books about neurological features. He has a beautiful book called The Man Who Thought That His Wife Was a Hat. So the most well-known book that he wrote is called Awakenings. Anyone knows about that? It was also a very famous movie. So Awakenings was written as a result of an epidemic in the United States of viral infections that left people catatonic. So they couldn't move at all. They were hospitalized in rigid statues in hospitals for many years. And then people started studying therapeutics for Parkinson's disease. And they developed this analog of dopamine, L-DOPA, which can go through the blood-brain barrier and replace, if you wish, the function of dopamine. And Oliver Sacks thought that these catatonic patients are also, something is really bad with the dopaminergic system because their movement control was impaired. And there were experiments done on these patients which were amazing because people that were 15 years in a rigid state in a bed suddenly moved and talked and woke up. And that's why the movie and the book are called Awakenings. Highly recommended. So this was a dramatic feature of the discovery of pharmacological control of the dopaminergic system. So again, the history goes like so. In the 1950s, people realized that dopamine is present in the brain and that the highest levels are in the striatum, which is the brain nucleus that the substantia nigra sends processes to. In 1960, two clinicians found that dopamine levels are really going down in Parkinson's patients. So until then, nobody knew what was going wrong. And as that's, I told you about, that the symptoms are only apparent when most of the cells in the substantia nigra are gone. So this is a synapse. Dopamine is synthesized from an amino acid, tyrosine. It's sent into the synaptic cleft, so the space between the nerve cell that sends it and the nerve cell that accepts it. And it interacts with dopamine receptors, okay? So these are the dopamine receptors. A lot of geneticists are studying dopamine receptors in search for hereditary differences in behavior. And Dick Epstein, who is here in psychology, published a set of papers that showed that some variation in the gene encoding for dopamine 1, the D1 receptor, are associated with differences in risky behavior. So if you go or you don't go to New Zealand and look for earthquakes, depends on your dopamine receptors. Unlike acetylcholine, dopamine is not degraded in the synaptic cleft, but it's taken back by a dopamine transporter to where it came from. Okay. So now we talk about L-DOPA. L-DOPA or levodopa was developed in the late 50s, and it's a precursor of dopamine, so it can degrade to yield dopamine, but its structure allows it, unlike dopamine itself, to cross the blood-brain barrier, and it functions, and it restores brain dopamine levels. It was tested first in mice, and it was shown that it could replace dopamine in animals without the nerve cells that are responsible. And then, again, they started giving patients dopamine or L-DOPA, and there were dramatic effects. People stopped tremoring, started running, they became very nervous though. So the dosage was a problem, and it still is. To balance a Parkinsonian patient on the right dose, the right type of pill, the right space between pills, when to take them, is not a simple issue at all. Yes?
How about the combination with carbidopa?
Again, it depends on the doctor, on the patient, on the combination of many factors. That's exactly what takes time. There are other drugs too. But still, L-DOPA is the major Parkinsonian drug. And there is a definition that clinicians use, which is called the L-DOPA honeymoon. For the first 5 years, patients react very well. They really stop tremoring. And then the drug stops functioning, and they need to find a replacement. But of course, the nerve cells go on dying, so it's not that surprising. So here is the blood-brain barrier. And suppose a patient gets levodopa, L-DOPA. The drug can work both in the periphery, and we said this is needed too, and cross the blood-brain barrier and work in the brain. There are two different enzymes that would degrade it in the periphery and another one that degrades it in the brain. So of course, pharmacologists decided to try to block those enzymes too. So not only give you a drug, but extend the longevity of the effect by blocking the drug's degradation. Rasagiline is actually a drug that was invented in the Technion and our School of Pharmacology together and is sold by Teva. So this blocks an enzyme called MAO, monoamine oxidase, right? But we'll take care of that. Why isn't L-DOPA ideal? Because the disease progresses and then the dosage becomes ineffective. Because chronic treatment affects motor function and causes sometimes dyskinesia, malmovement, neuropsychiatric problems. It does not prevent the death of the dopaminergic neurons. So it is, like Alzheimer's, it's a symptomatic treatment. It's not a therapeutic treatment that we are, okay? So now we were starting to discuss what, how do you diagnose Parkinson's disease? So the first thing is to go to a neurologist. They would run clinical examination. There is no biomarker available, not yet. There are proteins that can be taken in a blood test and say, yes, this person has the type of cancer, but not for Parkinson's. But there is a brain mapping activity test. So again, it's positron emission tomography, which means that this is a brain mapper that detects radioactivity. And what happens is that they take dopamine compounds, label them radioactively, inject them, and ask how effective is the binding in the regions of the brain where we know the substantia nigra is. And of course, you need to exclude other reasons. If someone used sprayed insecticides in huge quantities the day before and comes tremoring, this is transient and will hopefully go away. This is not Parkinsonism, for example. And this is how it looks. In a normal individual, we see the substantia nigra, so the labeled material highlights this region. In a Parkinsonian, with no treatment, we see a dramatic decline. And after treatment, this is not normal, but you see that there is a huge activation of the relevant neurons, okay? Okay, and I'd like to talk a little bit about stem cell therapy. So people talk about stem cell therapy for many diseases, but they started with Parkinson's disease for an obvious reason. This is a very small, very well-identified brain region, and the thought was, let's replace it. And there were attempts to try to transplant pieces of brain into the brain of patients, which would not be approved in this country in 200 years. It actually would not be approved in any civil society. It had been approved in South America. There were big centers that were built. And the stories were that women were convinced to develop embryos for the purpose of transplantation. That was the huge ethic problem with this attempt. And that's why it stopped everywhere today. But now we have another option of stem cells growing in culture, which do not involve this ethical problem. So the concept is to separate the nerve cells that are producing dopamine from the brain of an embryo, inject them into the substantia nigra of a patient, and hope that these cells will develop properly. And there were some successes. So just as a detour, let me tell you what is done today, which is very different ethically. So there is approval in many countries, although not all. In Europe, it is still a very big problem. In Israel, there is an official approval for outdated embryos that cannot be the source of developing a new baby. If the parents agree to donate them for research, then this is possible. And these are very small embryos, and they can be dissected to yield cells that can develop into any other cell type. People are developing procedures to push these cells into becoming dopaminergic neurons. So you start with the stem cell and you make it specialized. And then these cells can be transplanted. As far as I know, nobody's tried yet to transplant these cells to a human brain. They are being tried already to correct, for example, heart attack by transplanting muscle cells into the site of a scar in a damaged heart. They're tried for cartilage replacement, yes.
So, if it works in fine, why doesn't they use it in Alzheimer's?
Because it's a much more spread damage. Here you have one nucleus. That's the concept. In the heart, you know to identify the scar that was caused by the heart attack. If you transplant it there, then muscle tissue can solve the problem. The Alzheimer issue will be much more complicated, okay? And I'd like to show you a study. So we are not going to discuss the details, but I want you to look at the patterns of these patients. So this was a patient in Sweden. He developed the disease at the age of 37. The age of surgery was 48. And he lived 16 years after that first implantation into the left hemisphere, and 12 years after a second implantation to the right hemisphere, which probably helped him function. And then you have another patient from Sweden, United States, Canada. And now let's look again at the cause of death. What people died from is aspiration pneumonia, so they have a problem in controlling their muscles. Cardiac arrest, myocardial infarct, respiratory. So the cause of death agrees with Parkinson's disease. So what's going on? And what's going on is those stem cells developed and functioned. And because they lived in a microenvironment of a Parkinsonian brain, they developed the same Lewy bodies as the host neurons. It took years, so it gave this poor person 16 years more. That's a significant achievement. But still, there is a problem in transplanting nerve cells into a sick brain because they may get sick too. Okay, and here are the Lewy bodies that actually developed in the grafted neurons of the brain of a Parkinson's patient. Now, I want to go out and see what we can continue with. Okay. Okay. So let's talk now about surgical options. If the disease is so well characterized, can something else be done to activate the brain region that is damaged? And the thought was that actually, what stops us from doing what people do for after heart attack patients? That is, let's stimulate those nerve cells that lack a stimulus by electrical pulses. And the thought was started in 1950, and they started with general stimulation through the thalamus, which is a very big brain region fed by the substantia nigra. And then L-DOPA was introduced, and that was much better and much cheaper. So they stopped those treatments, and then renewed efforts started with monkeys in the 1990s. And the thought was that let's try to activate a small nucleus, much better characterized that feeds on the striatum just like the substantia nigra. The small nucleus is called the subthalamic nucleus, small region. And again, it started with rhesus monkeys, and it was seen that it solved tremor problems beautifully. And then it became a procedure in use with human patients. Okay, so this is Chagai Bergman. He's an expert on dopaminergic pathways. He'll come give you a lesson on the dopamine control over behavior. This is Tzvi Israel. He's a neurosurgeon in Hadassah. Chagai is an MD PhD, so he works most of his time in the university, but once a week he operates with Tzvi. And this is what they do. Their idea is to inject the subthalamic nucleus, to stimulate it with an electrode. And what we've done together was to take blood cells and see whether that causes changes also in the periphery. So here is where they implant, and patients carry a pacemaker, just like after a heart attack. And that stops tremor beautifully. And okay, here is the substantia nigra, and this is the subthalamic nucleus. So they have to be really precise in where they find the electrode. And this is a patient who has been, still is, he's an engineer in Hadassah, and he developed very early Parkinsonism, and you see him before and after the surgery. Okay, on the left, you see all of the symptoms we were discussing throughout this lesson. And in the right, you see that the person came back from being very, very sick. He went back to work. He regained control of fine movements. He's an electronic engineer, so he really needs that. This is an amazing surgery. It really is. In Hadassah, they did so far about 400 of those. They operate once a week. Implantation of an electrode to the subthalamic nucleus, and then using the pacemaker to adapt the electrical pulse to an optimal level that stops the tremor. So these patients still get some L-DOPA, but about 10% of what they needed before the surgery. It's really an amazing procedure. Okay, so this we are. Wait, this we will skip. But let me tell you that we looked at what happens in gene expression in white blood cells from patients before and after surgery. So what was the thought behind this study? It is very difficult to do genetic studies in human beings because they do not inbreed. In mice, we know these are the parents and it's the same colony. They all come from the same family. It is true that the Jewish community is also relatively limited. They say that the Ashkenazi community started from 3,000 individuals only, which is very little. And that this is why there is incidence of diseases that is much higher in the Jewish community. And perhaps this might be a reason for a difference in cognitive capacities in the Jewish community. But that's a side issue. Still, to run a proper genetic study, you need 10,000 individuals because the genetic variety interferes. And now we said, but here we have a golden opportunity. These are people who go through surgery that affects their peripheral functioning. So before surgery, they tremor. After surgery, they don't. Suppose we also ask them to agree for disconnecting the electrode for 1 hour. Within 15 minutes, they start tremoring. It's frightening. But if they do that, then we have three samples from the same patient, same genetics, before surgery, after surgery, and after surgery off stimulus. So we can identify what changes were caused by the disease compared to healthy controls or apparently healthy controls, which changes in gene expression in periphery were caused because of the surgery, and which of those are reversible when the patient goes tremoring again. So the idea is that the brain communicates with blood cells. It sends messages, and it sends those messages through acetylcholine. This is the major neurotransmitter that the brain sends to the periphery. This is the autonomic nervous system. It works for acetylcholine. Peripheral blood cells react to acetylcholine. Actually, you could look at these cells as a mini neuronal system, independent. They produce acetylcholine, they carry the receptors, they produce the protein that degrades acetylcholine, acetylcholinesterase. So they react to acetylcholine. What is the pattern of their reaction? When there is a lot of acetylcholine in the neighborhood, they stop producing inflammation markers, which implies that when someone has inflammation, that means that acetylcholine levels in the periphery are low. With age, people develop more and more markers of inflammation. And indeed, what happens with aging is that the protein that degrades acetylcholine, acetylcholinesterase, goes up in the blood with age, spontaneously. Now, people talk more and more about the association of inflammation with neurodegenerative disease. So we wanted to ask what happens to the genes that are expressed in white blood cells. Is that pattern modified in the disease? Is it modified after surgery? Is it modified again when we disconnect the battery? And this is what we see. The first comparison was controls versus Parkinsonian. And what you see here is that we have a lot of signaling pathways that are modified. The columns here show the variability. Decreases are shown in black, increases in white. You see that it goes all around the place. There's a lot of genes that go up and down. There's a major change in gene expression in the blood of Parkinson's disease patients. And this happens early, at the onset of the symptoms. We did not yet look at patients before because that's much more difficult. Then there is RNA metabolism genes that we'll skip, and inflammation, immune activities. There is an enhancement in inflammation, which actually goes in line with that prediction. And genes associated with the dopamine acetylcholine balance go down because this balance doesn't exist anymore. Then we said, now let's look at patients after surgery. And what happens here is we see a decline in, or if you compare increase to decrease, you see that there's a major decline in the Parkinsonian markers. And this goes together with stopping of the tremor. In any case, in each of these categories, you see an almost inverse pattern. So the surgery really reverses much of the changes that one sees in the blood of patients. What happens when we disconnect the battery? It's only 1 hour, and sure enough, we see return to the pattern of the disease. Okay, so now we said, is that connected to the efficacy of surgery? One problem with the deep brain stimulation is to find out which patients will benefit most from this surgery? Because nobody wants to go to an open brain surgery if they're not going to really benefit from that. And it's still not simple at all to find out those patients. Now, we looked at the differences in the neurological functioning, and you see here that the more change there is in blood gene expression, the better is the improvement of that patient. So we are hoping to develop that as a test so that those patients will be selected on a more well-grounded reason. But then the problem was that we looked at gene expression in DNA chips. DNA chips carry many, many tens of thousands of transcripts. And I was really interested in finding what we call a signature to limit the number of changes that we are measuring so that when we repeat the test, we will not need a DNA chip anymore, but we'll be able to make a small set of samples. So we looked at those genes that were modified in all four comparisons, between healthy and sick, between pre and post-surgery, and after disconnection, and comparing those after disconnection to the naive patients. And what we found was 25 genes that were modified in everybody. Now, what you see here is the way the computer classified the patients. So each line over here is a patient, and each row is a gene. And look at this. HC is healthy control. PD is a patient. But all of those, except for one, are called STEAM-ON. So these are patients after surgery, okay? And they classified together with the healthy controls. The computer did that, we didn't. And those that were stimulus off, so patients after surgery, which were disconnected from the battery for 1 hour, classified together with the Parkinsonian patients before surgery. So this is the classification, and here is what we call principal component analysis. For those of you who know a little bit statistics, we asked the computer, could you classify these people to groups? And the computer classifies them with healthy controls together with patients after surgery and Parkinsonian patients before surgery together with those that were off stimulus. You see there's only one here, and this guy actually was stimulus off for 1 hour, but he didn't tremor. And indeed, he showed up in the other group. And the nice thing was there's beautiful association between the changes we see in these genes and the neurological parameters that we didn't do. Of course, we do only the molecular biology. The neurologists do that. So this is a nice test. So then I said, okay. Now, other people did parallel tests. There is a group in Harvard that looked at 100 patients. Many of them were Parkinson patients, other were other diseases. They wouldn't tell us which diseases. And others were healthy controls, except that they looked at early patients. Patients before surgery are obviously the ones that are advanced and are really desperate to get better. What the Harvard group did was to look at patients at the very first diagnosis. And we said, let's see if some of the genes we detect are also seen in early patients. And you see those labeled in bold. So 6 of the 29 genes that we detect are also modified already in early disease, which makes us believe that maybe one day this will become an early diagnosis method before they have symptoms. So we asked the computer, can you classify them? So we took the 6 genes and we asked the computer to classify independently healthy control. No, these are not healthy controls. These are neurological controls. So these are patients with other diseases. Now the explanation is that the leading journals today would not let you publish an article that is based on DNA chips without depositing the data in the website so that other researchers can benefit from that. But they ask for a set of requests. They didn't ask them to specify which are the other diseases, and that they wouldn't give. They did whatever they could, and we used their data. However, look here. patients with other diseases classified largely different from patients with Parkinson's disease, except for two patients which came together with the Parkinsonian patients. And I did tell you that one third of Parkinson patients have dementia. And I would bet that these people have Alzheimer and Parkinson, because that's the most likely other neurological disease. So that was one comparison. And then we compared healthy controls in Parkinsonian. And again, the computer classified most of the healthy controls different, but some of the healthy controls classified with the Parkinsonian patients. And if I were them, I would go back to be diagnosed 3 years from now. Because it is possible that we saw changes that predict the occurrence of disease. So, what are the genes? Let me give you just a bite of which genes are we talking about. We talk about genes that are involved with RNA metabolism, so the shift from DNA to protein, or again with RNA metabolism, or again with RNA metabolism, or one of these six genes actually was found by others to be a Parkinsonian gene. Mutations in this gene cause Parkinson's disease. Or another one is involved with protein death, which we said is one process that goes bad in Parkinson. Or another one which is controlled under inflammation. So actually with six genes, we go back to most of the processes that I told you are impaired in Parkinson's disease. So we combined a little bit